Welcome to Spoken Injustice, where we put the criminal justice system in the dock. Whilst waiting for our trial to resume, in today's video, we're going to look at freedom of expression. We will first provide an overview of freedom of expression, both under the common law and under the European Convention of Human Rights. Then look at how this freedom has played an important part in the debate of wrongful convictions. And finally, we will look at cases, some recent, in which this freedom has been unduly restricted. As a general overview, freedom of expression is a fundamental right protected in the UK, both under the common law as well as under the Human Rights Act 1998, which incorporated the European Convention of Human Rights into UK law. The latter provides stronger and more specific protections. Common law does offer some degree of protection of freedom of expression through various legal principles and doctrines. For instance, the principle of open justice ensure that court proceedings are generally open to the public and the media, promoting transparency and public scrutiny. Additionally, the common law recognises the principle of freedom of the press, allowing the media to report on matters of public interest, which includes investigations into wrongful convictions. Common law does not provide an absolute guarantee of freedom of expression, and the courts may balance it against other competing interests, such as national security, public order, reputation, or rights of others. The European Convention on Human Rights, or ECHR for short, provides a more comprehensive and explicit protection to freedom of expression, providing at Article 10 that everyone has the right to hold opinions and to receive and impart information and ideas without interference by public authorities. Under the ECHR, the right to freedom of expression is also not absolute. However, it is further protected in that any restrictions must meet certain criteria, as defined in the second part of Article 10, which states that restrictions of freedom of expression must be, first of all, prescribed by law, secondly, pursue a legitimate aim, such as national security, public safety, or the protection of the rights of others, and three, be necessary in a democratic society. The European Court of Human Rights, which is responsible for interpreting and applying the ECHR, has developed a body of case law that further clarifies the scope and limitation of freedom of expression, stressing on the principles of proportionality and necessity when balancing the competing interests. The Human Rights Act 1998, which came into force on the 2nd of October 2000, incorporates the ECHR into UK law, making it directly enforceable by UK courts. Individuals in the UK can rely on the Human Rights Act to protect their freedom of expression, and the courts have a duty to interpret legislation in a way that it is compatible with the rights enshrined in the ECHR, including the right of freedom to freedom of expression. Before going into our second part of our video, which focuses on how freedom of expression and its protection had played a role on wrongful convictions, If you have enjoyed this video so far and believe that a wider audience may benefit from it, then please hit the like button and consider subscribing. This will allow the YouTube algorithms to do their magic and circulate this video to a wider audience. This will also result in our channel becoming more appealing to experts who we can invite so that we can bring you and our community the latest news into the quest for justice. As mentioned, the second part of this video focuses on the role that freedom of expression has played on the issue of wrongful convictions. When the criminal justice system fails to properly investigate and rectify wrongful convictions, it does not only irreversibly affect the life of those wrongfully convicted and their family and friends, but also erodes public trust in the system. Under a climate of fear and self-censorship, people may be hesitant to speak out against injustices or criticise the authorities if they believe that they could be wrongly targeted or face legal repercussions. Individuals who have wrongfully convicted have the right to share their stories and express their grievances, the right to seek and receive information and seek redress for the miscarriage of justice they have suffered, and ultimately contributing to the broader public discourse on criminal justice system reform and accountability. Of course, as we have already mentioned, freedom of expression is not an absolute right, and certain restrictions may be justified. However, any restrictions on freedom of expression must be necessary and proportionate. This freedom was put into discussion in the 90s when Ian Sims and Michael O'Brien, two prisoners, each serving life imprisonment and claiming to be innocent, wanted a journalist to investigate their side of the story so that their cases could be re-examined. However, prison authorities placed restrictions on both Sims and O'Brien being interviewed by the press on the basis that any oral interviews between prisoners and journalists will tend to disrupt discipline and order in prisons. In response to that action, Sims and O'Brien took their case to the highest UK courts, the Supreme Court, which at the time was known as the House of Lords, invoking the right of freedom of speech under the common law. The court found that until the Home Secretary imposed a blanket ban on oral interviews between prisoners and journalists in or about 1995, such interviews had taken place from time to time and had served to identify and undo a substantial number of miscarriages of justice. There is no evidence that any of these interviews had resulted in any adverse impact on prison discipline. Secondly, the evidence establishes clear that without oral interview, it is now virtually impossible under the Home Secretary's blanket ban for a journalist to take up the case of a prisoner who alleges a miscarriage of justice. In the process, the court said, a means of correcting errors in the functioning of the criminal justice system has been lost. The court concluded that the policy of preventing journalists from interviewing prisoners violated the right to free speech. So, how did Mr. Mark Alexander, a prisoner who claims to have been wrongly convicted of the murder of his father found himself in exactly the same position in 2022, especially in light of the stronger protections afforded by the Human Rights Act 1998, which came into force in 2000 and which was not available at the time when Sims and O'Brien cases were decided. Let's take a look at Mr. Alexander's case. Mr. Alexander was convicted of the murder of his father in 2010. An application to the Court of Appeal for leave to appeal against his conviction was refused on the papers, and again upon oral renewal in June 2011. In 2015, an application to the CCRC for his case to be referred to the Court of Appeal was refused by the Commission. On 21st of November 2020, Mr. Alexander wrote a letter to his governor that his family had agreed to participate in a multi-part podcast for BBC Radio, re-examining his case, and that the production company was seeking permission to record and broadcast conversations with Mr. Alexander over the phone in relation to his claim of innocence. The letter received no reply, and in April 2021, Mr. Alexander submitted a formal complaint. The governor, in response to the complaint, indicated that he was willing to support the request, but that he needed the approval of the press office. In June 2021, however, the governor refused the request, stating that it did not meet policy criteria. And in September 2021, Mr. Alexander challenged the refusal by way of judicial review. However, Mr. Alexander's judicial review claim included additional evidence that was not part of his original request. On that basis, in November 2021, a fresh application was made to the government. The fresh application, however, was also refused in December 2021. So let's look at the background law and policies upon which these types of decisions are made. First, it is important to note that circumstances under which prisoners are allowed access to the media through visits or telephone are exceptional and subject to applications to be considered by the prisoner's governors and directors, and in the case of face-to-face interviews, such applications are considered centrally on behalf of the Secretary of State. How so, you may ask? Well, Section 47, subsection 1 of the Prisons Act 1952 provides that the Secretary of State may make rules for the regulation and management of prisons. These rules currently consist of Prison Rules 1999-728. These rules provide that contact with the outside world is a privilege operating by way of exception to the general rule that an ancillary incident of incarceration is the absence of such contact. Consequently, prison policies are developed under this frame, and the policy in relation to prisoners' access to the media is no exception. Previously, this policy was outlined in the Prison Service Order number 4470 of 2005. This was, however, replaced by the Prison Service Instructions number 37 of 2010, which is said to have introduced amendments to the criteria for consideration and handling of requests for face-to-face meeting with the media. It is said to have clarified that there may be additional exceptional circumstances other than an alleged miscarriage of justice in which there is a sufficiently strong public interest in what is being said and by the prisoner that requires a face-to-face interview. For example, if a prisoner alleges torture by public official. According to this policy, prisoners can communicate with the media in three ways: written correspondence, telephone, and visits. In relation to written correspondence, most prisoners will be able to contact the media through letters only. Prisoners do not need permission for the governor to send or receive letters from the media, but there are restrictions on what can be sent out. In relation to telephones, if a prisoner wishes to contact the media by telephone and the call is intended or likely to be published or broadcast by radio or television or posted on the internet, the prisoner must first apply in writing to the governor for permission. The governor must decide whether to permit the application in liaison with the press office. This will only be allowed in exceptional circumstances where the prisoner intends to make serious representations about matters of legitimate public interest affecting prisoners, including, where appropriate, an alleged miscarriage of justice in the prisoner's own case, and where the other criteria in Section 3 are met. We will look at the criteria shortly. And in relation to visits, prisoner must apply in writing to the governor if they wish to receive a visit from a member of the media, and copies of such requests must be passed immediately to the press office. Decision on such request will now, once the governor has given his or her view, be made centrally on behalf of the Secretary of State. Press office will consult ministers where appropriate. In the specific case of telephone interviews, this will be allowed, say the policy or instructions, where the criteria in Section 3 are met. And what are the criteria? A telephone conversation must be the most suitable method of communication. For example, where the prisoner needs to provide comment as a matter of urgency due to the immediacy of the subject, or the media needs to report it within a time scale that could not be met by written correspondence. And secondly, the sole purpose of the conversation is to comment on matter of legitimate public interest affecting prisons or prisoners, including, where appropriate, an alleged miscarriage of justice in the prisoner's own case. Further, distress to victims and or outrage to public sensibilities will not result from the broadcast. This is likely to occur if, for example, the prisoner's crimes or conduct are recent, notorious, or horrific. In such circumstances, permission may be refused. And if reasonable guarantees can be provided by the broadcaster, the listener will not be able to, for example, identify the prisoner, including by name, voice, or by any description of his or her crime, then this may provide grounds for permitting a telephone call which will otherwise fall to be refused. And permitting the telephone call will not pose a threat to security or to good order or discipline, and can be arranged without undue disruptions to existing staff duties. Particular regard should be given to the likelihood of inciting ill feeling amongst other prisoners. And finally, there is no reason to doubt that the journalist, broadcaster, or prisoner will respect and abide by any reasonable conditions required of them, and that they will do everything practicable to take the discussion within prison regulations. In the specific case of Mr. Alexander, the governor refused the request as follows. He said, "I do not consider that a telephone conversation is the most suitable method of communication. And I consider there is a risk that the interview might cause distress to victims, and that an interview with a man convicted of murdering his father creates a risk of outrage to public sensibility. For this reason, I have refused your application. I'm sorry that this is not the result that you wished. However, the policy is explicit that application of this kind should only be granted exceptionally, and I do not consider that your application cannot be satisfactorily dealt with by correspondence." The governor's reason for his conclusions were as follows. "I do not think that this," referring to the request, "is urgent or immediate, such that written correspondence will not be adequate. You have tried to argue in your letter that communicating in the ordinary way by correspondence is unsuitable because the broadcasters thinks an interview will be more appropriate. Because he thinks that an interview would enable him to ask you questions that would enable the public to assess your claim of innocence, and that an interview conducted by correspondence would mean it was unlikely to receive a commission. I have taken account of those arguments. They do not show urgency as required under the criteria 3.2. The fact that the broadcaster thinks a telephone interview would be appropriate does not make it urgent. And it is not a compelling reason to depart from the policy. Regarding the second point, the broadcaster could also put question to you in writing, and that would enable the public to assess your claim critically as you wish. Your third point, that the broadcaster thinks an interview conducted by letter is less likely to receive a commission, is not relevant under the policy. The prison service has to have regard to its own policies and not to irrelevant considerations, such as the chance that a particular form of communication will be more attractive to a commissioning editor. On the 23rd of May 2023, these matters were ventilated at a hearing before Mr. Justice Andrew Baker in the High Court of Justice King's Bench Division Administrative Court. A judgment dated 16th of June 2023 was then handed down. Mr. Justice Baker found that the governor misdirected himself in relation to the first criterion by referring to urgency as if this was a prerequisite for authorizing a telephone interview. However, urgency is cited merely as one instance where a telephone conversation might be the most suitable method of communication and should not be seen as a prerequisite. Placing so much focus on the urgency element, the judge found, the governor failed to appropriately assess the expert opinion provided by the broadcaster. The broadcaster advised that the proposed podcast series was going to be required for the claimant's claim of innocence to be capable of attracting sufficient attention to draw out from the general public new evidence or lines for inquiry, and that a telephone interview was essential to the prospect of the proposed podcast series being commissioned. In other words, without it, the podcast will not be made. Justice Baker found that in no way the expert opinion could be said to be irrelevant. In fact, it was a central element of the claim that telephone contact would be more suitable than written correspondence if the communication by the claimant of what he has to say is to become disseminated widely enough to be of potential value. Finally, in relation to the third criterion, Justice Baker sided with Mr. Alexander on the basis that, firstly, in the circumstances of this unusual case, no victim other than the claimant's father himself has ever been identified. This criterion does not have in mind victims of crime in some generic or abstract sense, but identifiable direct or indirect victims of the particular crime about which the prisoner, here the claimant, wishes to be free to communicate through telephone contact with the media. And secondly, the governor appears to have taken the view that no matter what the content or purpose of the interview, it will be a public outrage for the media to be allowed to talk to someone convicted of murdering their father whilst they're still in custody following that conviction. This is not a rational view. In conclusion, Mr. Justice Baker found that the refusal letter was misdirected and an irrational decision to refuse the claimant's requests to be allowed to give a telephone interview to the broadcaster, and accordingly quashed it. However, though Mr. Justice Baker quashed the refusal letter, he declined to grant further relief beyond that. He ordered the governor to consider the claimant's request afresh. He stated that there is no reason to consider that he, the governor, might be unable to address the claimant's request for permission afresh, taking directions as to the meaning of the policy from this judgment. He stated that the justice of this case is served by the quashing of the refusal letter and the consequent requirement upon the governor to consider afresh the claimant's request. We will keep you updated as soon as we have news. I hope you have found this video useful, and if so, please let us know in the comments below. Also, like it and subscribe to our channel if you have not done so already, so that we can invite prominent experts to elucidate some of the most problematic issues involved. And of course, join our networking hub at spokeninjustice.net to have your say as to the future content of this channel. Join us again next week. We look forward to usher you as we sit and rise in this unique trial.